said, I could do that. I could do that.
That is Wayne's number. Well, first, first let me say what you already know. You look marvelous, and I mean that in no patronizing way. You're all, you've taken very good care of yourself, and all of you are still working, some of you in theater, some of you are not. And one person is in the show as we speak and has to leave us early for a matinee. You know who it is? The one person still in the show? I'm not going to tell you. Yes, I will. It's Robert Lupone. Zach, you're in the current company. And you've got to leave, actually? Yeah. Well, what was your hiatus? How long were you gone from...
13 years.
He's still good.
And well, you've got to tell us. You know, what's it like going? Is it deja vu all over again, as Yogi might say?
No,
it's different.
Yeah, totally. I mean, it's hard.
He's Mike. I think he's Mike.
It's hard to.
Sorry.
It's hard to. I mean, obviously, I'm working with other actors, and we are doing the show every night, so it's hard to compare in the sense that they bring to the show what they know about the show, but. I was telling the cast, our friends of mine in the cast here before, that clearly the history that we have and the experience that we had doing this show will never compare to me or any other company.
Let us speak to that for just a moment, and you will all get in here. Don't be shy. I feel like the conductor at the Mormon Tabernacle Choir. First of all, Chorus Line is not about young people trying to break into show business. Chorus Line is about people who are in show business. Chorus Line is about dancers who may or may not get this job. God, I need this job. Are you too fat? Are you too thin? Are you too old? Are your breasts too big or too small? What about your hairline? And you sat with Michael Bennett in rooms to talk about your own personal... You're nodding with affirmation here. You were right here. And he brought... some of your stories were brought in toto to this... to the play and others' portions thereof. Talk about that. Didn't you? You had your own therapy to bring this, to get this play, this musical on its feet. Who wants to start?
Well, I think Wayne should start because he was there.
All right, Wayne.
He took my story. He didn't believe that I had a kid and a wife and a house, so he gave it to him, and I took Sammy's story. I didn't want it, but I got it.
But please review, as you do in this book, which I am pleased to recommend to our viewers, On the Line is the story of the creation of a Chorus Line, which I am told as we speak, having played now in 24 countries, every day of the calendar year, the curtain goes up in some country of the world on a Chorus Line. I believe now we're talking of proceeds in excess of $250 million. Where were you when this... Really? You didn't get it? And I want you to know something else, and I better shut up here because we've got a big cast. You were paid a dollar for your own stories.
That's right.
Uh-huh.
And I will hold up for the rest of the
Take that mic, Nancy. That's right.
We did sign away our lives for a dollar. All the rights, all the logo things, all everything that you see our picture on, we get...
Puppets.
Yeah. Here's the, incidentally, here's
Bloomingdale's.
The Bloomingdale's
towel.
You don't. Your likeness is literally on here.
That's right.
That's right.
May I add something?
Yeah. Yeah.
You're also on bath towels. And many years ago, when the show was a hit, do you kids remember this? Kids. We can call each other kids. And we couldn't get a charge card at Bloomingdale's, but they wanted us to go. Oh, is it all right to say Bloomingdale's? Is Betsy
going
to be upset?
Sure, why not? This is America.
And they wouldn't give us charge cards, but they wanted us to go and, of course, help them sell the product. And I think we all took a stand and we got our charge cards, which I hope none of us ever used. But anyway.
Yeah, but let's not presume that everybody understands how this magnificent creative idea was born. You sat and poured your soul out about your own life, what your mother said, what your father said. Some of you talked about adolescent experiences. Will she kiss you? Won't she kiss you?
About eight of us that are here met on a snowy Sunday or Saturday night over on the east side, and we call this the tape sessions. And the tape sessions were done like a group therapy, and there were about 25 dancers there that were working or not working, and that's how this kind of evolved. And everyone told a little bit about their childhood, a little bit about getting to New York, a little bit about their first job, pretty much the way the show runs.
And pain.
Yeah, it was tough.
Somebody's mother said, gee, when you grow up, maybe you'll be pretty or something.
Right.
That was you? Now, Tell me.
That was my mother.
Nancy.
No, it's in the book, but what had happened, and this used to be a monologue of mine. It has gone into At the Ballet. It's part of the lyric of At the Ballet, and Nancy has the pleasure of singing that. But we talked about the whole idea of going into the business and what you needed in the business. And I was saying to all of them that night, I said, remember that Doris Day song, Que Sera, Sera, and will I be pretty, will I be rich? And so I went to my mom like this, and I said, will I be pretty when I grow up? And she said, no. She said, you'll be very attractive, and you'll be very different, and you'll have a wonderful flair about you, but you won't
pretty.
Be pretty.
No.
And I was very disappointed. I have to say, the lyricist said I hated her. I didn't hate her, but I was unhappy.
Right. But as a matter of fact, you did share this, did you not? This was going on inside a creative room where people were tape recording you for purpose of how to... You had a mass group therapy here in which not a few people cried, lots of people got angry. Who wants in?
Well, I just want to say something that, you know, the thing that was marvelous about
Let me just say that Kelly, we should say, as Sheila won the Tony for Best Supporting Actress, Donna, you won Tony for your part. I want to get this in. Excuse the interruption.
The thing that I found for me was the experience of going to this, and Michael asked three questions to begin us off. Three questions that I think are still in the show. And it started kind of superficially as people started talking and more people revealed more. People that you thought you knew you dressed next to in other shows, you realized that we all had dreams and private dreams and some shameful secrets.
Right.
We thought it broke down a certain kind of barrier, and that feeling tone of that got in the play. There was something there. By the end of the first evening, the emotions flowed because people were more felt safe. All of a sudden those barriers dropped and people were eager to reveal. When we came upon, I'm jumping way ahead,
no,
but
right.
The composite of characters.
Yeah.
Like my character is a composite of many people. My real life is on that whole stage all night in six characters, as many of us are.
Right.
We found out that so much of our common experience, we couldn't all say we had the same experiences, so Michael made certain characters say specific things. So this was, you know...
This was not a play that you walked out, got the script, stood there and auditioned for. You brought your soul, all your baggage.
Some people auditioned with their own stories, though, didn't they?
Please do.
My sister's here, and she was one of the ones that auditioned at that same time, and I did her monologue. So the barriers in those tapes sessions that she's talking about, I never released that barrier because my sister was right beside me, you know, answering the questions prior to me answering them. And she's like, if I may say so, 3 years older. And I, you know.
You may say so.
I always looked up to her, you know, so there were certain things that I didn't reveal at that time in that tape session. So I was kind of the dark horse.
And.
But the strange thing about it was that people walked into that room and auditioned for their life and didn't get it. They walked out of that room not getting the part. Because
it was never about how well you danced or how well you looked. It was what your being was about. It was what your personality was about. It was what your presence was about, what you could bring to the stage. The other thing, I came in on the project a little bit later than some of the people. I replaced someone on the project. And when I arrived, Sammy had already told my story. I, too, followed my sister into dancing school and sat there. And when she left, I picked up her dancing shoes, and Wayne wound up doing our number. But, you know, and it is a common denominator here.
Yeah.
We all have very similar stories and come from very different dysfunctional backgrounds,
right,
where we were shamed, et cetera, et cetera.
Right.
And,
no.
Phil, that's the reason why we wrote this book called On the Line.
This is a very compelling book. I am pleased to...